two parts are number one piriform fossa, number two post-cricoid prefrontal wall, and piriform fossa, post-cricoid area, and posterior pharyngeal wall. Basically, this posterior pharyngeal wall is same as that of the oropharynx, which is continuing downwards. That is why main areas are piriform fossa and post-cricoid, but we also include this posterior pharyngeal wall into the anatomical division. Basically, it has two areas. Okay, you can see in the diagram, this is piriform fossa on either side of the larynx. Okay, these are two piriform fossae, and it is bounded medially by area epiglottic fold and laterally by the lamina of the thyroid cartilage. Okay, there are two piriform fossae. Okay, and behind the cricoid cartilage, this is the cricoid cartilage, is the area that is post-cricoid area. This is the actually post-cricoid area. Okay, this area is the post-cricoid area. You can see in this diagram, this is the live diagram which is taken with the help of 70 degree telescope. You can see this is area epiglottic fold. This is epiglottis. Okay, this is the area epiglottic fold. Lateral, this is a true vocal cord. Okay, lateral to this area epiglottic fold is the area which is called piriform fossa or piriform sinus. Further lateral is this is the lamina, area of the lamina of thyroid cartilage. Okay, you can understand these are two piriform fossae. These are the part of hypopharynx. Now the piriform fossa, they are paired. They extend from pharyngoepiglottic fold to upper end of esophagus. Okay, it is bounded laterally by inner surface of the thyroid ala, medially by the area epiglottic fold. I have shown you that in diagram. Okay, it has very rich lymphatic drainage. Okay, that is why the tumor of piriform fossa, it get metastasized very early into the lymph node, regional lymph nodes. It is very, it has very rich lymphatic drainage. You can see in this diagram the arytenoid, and this is the area of area. This is area epiglottic fold. This is the area of the piriform fossa. Okay, where you can see the saliva. Saliva is always in food passage, not the airway. Okay, this is the area of piriform fossa. You can see the tumor in the area of piriform fossa. Okay, in the left piriform fossa, there is a big tumor. You can see in this diagram. Post-cricoid area. Post-cricoid area is behind the larynx and extend from the level of arytenoid cartilage to the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage. From arytenoid cartilage till inferior border of the, basically it is behind the cricoid cartilage. That is called post-cricoid, posterior to the cricoid cartilage. Okay, in diagram you can see this is the area of post cricoid region. Okay, this is the thyroid lamina, and this is cricoid cartilage. Behind the cricoid cartilage, this is the area of post cricoid region. Okay, the tumor of this area is very lethal. Okay, and it is usually the tumor which is present in female. In female, the post-cricoid area tumor is very common, and in male, piriform fossa tumor is common. Now, is the posterior pharyngeal wall, it extends from the level of hyoid bone till the inferior border of the inferior margin of the cricoid cartilage, below and lateral to the posterior margin of piriform fossa. This is basically below and lateral to the posterior margin of piriform fossa. Okay, this is posterior pharyngeal wall. Tumor of this area is also common, but not very common as that of the piriform fossa. And the number one common is piriform fossa, then number two is post-cricoid area, and number three is posterior pharyngeal wall tumor. Okay, lining of hypopharynx, as you know, is stratified squamous, non-keratinized epithelium. So carcinoma will be squamous cell carcinoma, which is the most common tumor of the hypopharynx. Okay. Tumor may be benign, it may be malignant in nature. Benign tumors are very rare, malignant tumors are common. And the most common is, I have told you, squamous cell carcinoma. As you know, the epithelium is stratified squamous epithelium, that is why the carcinoma is squamous cell carcinoma, which is the most common. Preform fossa, 60% patient, okay. And post-cricoid area, 33%. And posterior phalangeal wall, 10%. Okay. The ratio of tumor is 60, 30, and 10. Okay. Now coming to the pathology. For the pathology, preform fossa tumor, it's 75% of tumor cases, they will metastasize to the regional lymph nodes, and half will metastasize to the bilateral lymph nodes. Okay, as you know, the just like nasopharynx, hypopharynx also has a rich lymphatic drainage, and it has bilateral, because it is in the center, hypopharynx is in the center, it has bilateral lymphatic drainage. And that is why the tumor metastasized to the other side in half of the cases as bilateral spread, and in 75% it will metastasize to the 75% of cases will metastasize to the one side lymph nodes. Okay, and post-cricoid area tumor at 20% cases will metastasize to the lymph node at the time of presentation. It is basically a percentage at the time of presentation. Now, causes: smoking and alcoholism. Okay, that is why Allah has forbidden us not to take these things. Has ordered us not to take these things. Epidemiology: as you know, it is a tumor of old age, basically. More common in males, preform fossa tumor. I have told you already. Post-cricoid area, more common in female. And about 90% with a history of Plummer-Vinson or Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome. As you know, Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome or Plummer-Vinson syndrome, patient will be having dysphagia, glossitis, angiostomatitis, okay, anemia. Patient will be anemic. And usually in female. This is a disease of female, usually. That is why post-cricoid area tumor is more common in female, and it is about 90% of the patient with Patterson-Brown-Kelly, they develop, they have the post-cricoid tumor. So one should investigate a patient with Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome. The tumor should be ruled out in this case. Clinical features, that is understood, will be having dysphagia, patient will be having dysphagia. First of all, at the time of presentation, neck, most of the patient, in 90% of the post-cricoid area, preform fossa tumors, patient will present with neck swelling. Okay. So, capacity of the hypopharynx allows considerable tumor growth before the passage of food hindrance. Okay, because it is very widened area, so all the patient does not present with dysphagia. Some of the patient will present with dysphagia, in which the tumor has a very big size. Neighboring structures such as larynx is involved. Patient will be having, along with dysphagia, patient will be having dyspnea or hoarseness of voice, or pubertal muscles may be invaded. Patient may be having pain of the neck. Early lymph node metastasis to jugular, retropharyngeal, paratracheal, and mediastinal lymph nodes. Okay. These are symptoms. Patient will be having pain, and pain will be lateralized, maybe ipsilateral, maybe bilateral. If the tumor is ipsilateral, it will be ipsilateral, bilateral, bilateral pain, and pain will be radiating towards the ear. Okay. Or pain may be localized to the area of neck. Now the dysphagia, in 80% of the cases, patient will be having dysphagia. Discomfort on swallowing. Patient will be having discomfort on, once the patient swallow, he or she will feel discomfort on swallowing. neck mass visible. Okay. Hemoptysis, patient may be having bleeding from the mouth, oral cavity. Patient may be having hemoptysis. Okay. Patient may be having hoarseness of voice once the larynx is enrolled with the tumor. Weight loss, the anorexia and weight loss. With the help of indirect laryngoscope, you can see this is indirect laryngoscopic mirror, and one can see the area of hypopharynx with this mirror. Data says the fibrotic flexible nasal endoscope. And another latest investigation is 70 degree telescope. It will show us the area of hypopharynx. You can see this area is visible. Examination, indirect laryngoscopy, fibrotic nasal endoscope, 70 degree telescope. Thorough head and neck examination should be done. Lymphoid should be palpated. Level of the lymphoid should be mentioned. Should be. There is loss of laryngeal capitis. When we will move the laryngeal cartilage side to side, there will be no crepitus, okay, which we may indicate post-cricoid opospongy wall tumor. Loss of laryngeal capitis, okay. You can see in this diagram, there is tumor of the hypopharynx. This is barium swallow, which is showing a filling defect, okay. This is the tumor. This is normal filling of the hypopharynx, of the piriform fossa of the hypopharynx, is a part of hypopharynx, and this is filling defect, okay. And you can also see the area, there is a tumor which is causing obstruction to the four tusks. This is X-ray and barium swallow. Now one can pass endoscope and can see the tumor. This is area of hypopharynx, that is piriform fossa. This is second piriform fossa. Okay. And one can pass laryngoscope. If the tumor is detected with the help of fibrotic flexible endoscope, so go for direct laryngoscopic examination of the tumor. It will show us the extension of the tumor, the areas involved, whether either larynx is involved or not, either vocal cords are normal, mobile, or fixed. Okay, it will give us the clue about the diagnosis of the patient. Okay, so one should also go for laryngoscopic examination of the larynx and hypopharynx. Okay, you can see this is CT scan, which is showing the tumor of the hypopharynx. This is the tumor of hypopharynx. And also this CT scan, you can see the tumor in the area of hypopharynx. This is barium swallow showing a filling defect in this area. This is the area of tumor. Okay, this is the area of tumor. Investigation, radiological investigation, very important, and endoscopy with biopsy. HB to see whether either patient is having permanence or not, full blood count, serum iron level, barium studies, very important, XHS to see the secondary, CT scan to see the tumor, its extension, its size, its site. Okay. Now the differential diagnosis of the hypopharyngeal tumors. There may be reflex stricture or esophagitis, pharyngoesophageal dysmotility, and pharyngeal web. Pharyngeal pouch. Okay. These are the area treatment. Now the treatment, very important. Piriform fossa lesions, they should be the option is radiotherapy for the smaller lesions without palpable neck mass. Okay, if the lymph nodes are not involved, then one can go for radiotherapy. It's for early stage tumors, okay, small size tumors. And large size tumor option is total laryngopharyngectomy for large tumors. And if, and in this case, neck nodes are really palpable. And one can combine with radical neck dissection. And not only the laryngopharyngectomy, also if there is spread of the tumor to the postcoital region or cervical part of the esophagus, cervical esophagus, so there may be, one has to go for reconstruction by stomach pull-up or colon transposition. So because the area has been resected, the stomach is pulled up and anastomosis of the food passage is done. Okay. So it is the reconstruction by stomach or colon transposition. Postcoital area lesions, they need radiotherapy if the lesion is small, just like peripheral fossa tumors. Otherwise, total laryngopharyngoesophagectomy. Remove the parts of larynx, pharynx, and esophagus. And reconstruction with the same stomach pull-up or colon transposition. Now, postoesophageal lesions. So option is radiotherapy for small lesions. Surgery if metastatic lymphoid neck nodes is there. Thank you very much. Any question regarding this? Students, any question? ठीक है बेटा.